Hi everybody, I hope you're well. Today we'll read from a book titled Johan Celsing Buildings Texts, edited by Pamela Johnston and published by Park Books.
Årsta Church. The church is located on a hill overlooking the square at Årsta, a post-war suburb of Stockholm, well known for its public buildings such as a community center with library and auditorium by the distinguished architects Erik and Tore Olsin. The parish first built a bell tower in 1952, followed by a parish building in 1968. The parish hall functioned as a chapel until the church was inaugurated in August 2011. The project for the church started in an invited competition in 2006. These designs would give way to the notion that the most important architectural aspect should be the use of elementary means and building components to bring a concentration and dignity to the primary rituals of the space: baptism, mass, funerals, and weddings. The floor area of the church is only 13 meters by 13 meters. The design was inspired by the idea of a standing congregation, as in an Orthodox church, with the benches that accentuate the profile of the walls serving as seating for the elders. For its tactile qualities, the lower part of the walls is of white glazed bricks. Farther up, the walls are painted with several layers of traditional lime wash. These walls are massive and load-bearing, 88 centimeters thick, with cavities for insulation but without expansion joints. To articulate the quality of the light entering the church, the windows have lateral niches. The ceiling is of in-situ cast concrete. For acoustic reasons, the horizontal parts have perforations, diameter 75 millimeters, set 200 millimeters apart. The detailing of the walls, ceiling, and furniture is intended to complement the elementary space with a calm but palpable sense of care. The sacristy walls are in red glazed brick, while the children's chapel has green glazed bricks and chubby chairs of ambiguous size and elementary character. The position of the altar and baptismal font on the east-west axis is meant to provide a sense of direction in the square space, but also to mark the liturgical foundation when the church is used for other activities such as music and recitals. The west door faces a new outdoors entry space at the foot of the bell tower. The tower also has a strong presence in the main social entrance located where the church connects with the earlier parish building. When merging the church with the existing building, the ambition was to cast the two parts into a new whole. Particular care was taken to maintain the integrity and character of both the new and old surfaces when merging rooms, such as the existing entry, which doubled in size. In the new part of this particular room, the ceiling was cast using timber formwork with boards of the same kind and dimensions as the whitewashed suspended ceiling of the old part, which was left unaltered. There was no ambition to mark out the old from the new or stress the edges where they meet. This attitude also prevails on the exterior. However, up close or to the attentive visitor, it is evident that the new parts are built in very different bricks and with quite different ambitions from the original building. The idea of having light wells provided the initial impetus for the design of the roof. For a long time, I had been inspired by the intricate lighting in Baroque churches, with their use of more or less hidden sources of light. I also had in mind certain mystical qualities of a low-lit interior, but at a particular point, after many studies, I capitulated in face of the gravity of the task. Evidently, the work was not to be an advanced light machine, but a down-to-earth ritual space in a Stockholm suburb. After that, I started working with large but elementary openings in the walls. All that remains of the previous advanced roof structure and light wells are the lateral recesses which provide the 88 cm thick walls with a delicacy that I feel is a fruitful contrast to their otherwise almost medieval dimensions. Having moved the light openings from the roof to the walls, the task at hand was to arrange the structure and character of the roof. Early studies included a central double beam that crossed the church in an east-west direction. While this solution was certainly realistic, it would have emphasized an overly elementary approach, which did not seem to be what I was looking for. Next came studies of an arrangement with two beams running in a north-south direction, crossed by two beams running from east to west. This resulted in a 9-square grid, a symmetrical cassette ceiling that was certainly powerful, although it stressed the importance of symmetry to a degree that I felt was inappropriate for this church, too strict or dry from my point of view. The symmetrical 9-square cassette ceiling gave way to studies of a more directional east-west arrangement of the beams. This solution seemed very exciting, and the beams grew to become wooden trusses as high as the windows, 5 meters. The square church thus became a church of 3 aisles, although the openness of the trusses meant that the aisles would also have been open to each other. After these elaborate variations, I had to once again sober up and yield to what seemed to be the real problem to solve: how to make an appropriate ritual space for people grieving at a funeral or experiencing nerves at the rites of passage. As I searched for something less spectacular, I randomly scattered beams in the way you sometimes see when you peek into a derelict barn in the Swedish countryside and find the jumble of structure lit by the rays of sun passing through the broken roof. This seemed to be a road not taken that would be worth trying. Sven Etzler in my office rapidly built models and made renderings that proved it could make sense. I adjusted the inclinations so that the beams above the altar would be parallel with the eastern wall, thereby maintaining a calm in this important position. All the beams rest on walls rather than on top of light openings. While their arrangement may be thought willful, the beams are lower in height than the previous east-west trusses. The choice of angled beams made it possible to drop earlier solutions that were even less desirable. But what finally confirmed the ceiling arrangement was that it introduced a certain understated but also unexpected tension into the symmetrical church. I felt that the skewed directions of the beams liberated the space from its ordered ground plan. The arrangement seemed in some way to respond to those feelings we all experience on ritual occasions. You may feel you are not properly dressed, the sermon may be boring, or you don't know the bride or don't like the groom. While reflecting on such matters, the unexpected sight of the ceiling would in some way resonate with this feeling we all have at times, of being at odds with things.
Ask for the book at your local bookstore. Thank you for watching and see you in the next video. Bye.